Hi, this is Vikki, your cartoon critic. Today I'm going to start off a new segment called Vikki's Favorites, where I not only reveal my real name is Vikki, but I take a look at some of my favorite films outside of cartoons. Over a year ago, I started looking up every top 10, top 100, top whatever lists on the internet of the most disturbing movies ever made, and decided to watch them just to see what all the fuss was about. But what started as some bizarre curiosity grew into something more. It wasn't that I was interested in the plots of these films, but it was actually more interesting to see what their origins were and the history behind them, and how they affected the people after their release. Cannibal Holocaust is my favorite example to use for this. Known for its realistic death scenes and for some very real animal death scenes, Cannibal Holocaust is not for the weak of stomach, but its history is definitely interesting. Like the fact that a scene depicting a woman impaled on a wooden stake caused the director to have to prove to a federal court that he didn't actually kill her. Needless to say, this film has been banned from several countries for its content, and it remains to be one of the most controversial films of its time. Now, for obvious reasons, there are some of these movies that I've seen that I'm not going to make video reviews for. For one thing, I'd have to black box them every 30 seconds, but for another, it's kinda awkward admitting to a camera you've seen some of this stuff, especially when I'm not entirely positive who my viewing audience is. Hi, Mom! Which is why I originally started a blog called Ye Be Warned, where I talked about all these movies and whether or not I thought they were really that disturbing or not. But once in a while, I come across films that I know I can easily make video reviews for. And since one of these films finally ended up becoming probably my most favorite movie of all time, I decided to make a review for it.
When I grow up, I want to be a track star.
Do you remember those silly PSAs you saw on TV as a kid and probably still sometimes catch during commercial breaks?
This is crack.
The one where your brain becomes fried eggs or a psycho bitch with a frying pan? What about those stupid informative videos of the evils of drugs that you had to watch in health class? Let's be honest, did any of these ever make you not want to do drugs? Of course not! They were stupid and very unrealistic, and in the end you walk away thinking like every typical teenager does. Well, that won't happen to me. And you're probably right, it probably won't.
This wasn't supposed to be your life!
So naturally, when I happened upon this movie on a few most disturbing films lists, and I saw the main premise revolved around drugs, my brain immediately went to Reefer Madness and figured, well, this'll probably be stupid, but at least I'll get a few laughs out of it. Oh boy, I was wrong. To be fair, this movie is not just about drugs, it's more about life, and dealing with the nasty things that can happen to you and how your daily choices can potentially ruin you in ways you never even imagined. And today I'm gonna talk about it, so let's take a look at Requiem for a Dream. Our film opens on an infomercial. Oh, and if you rent the DVD version of this movie, this is also your title screen. At first I thought Netflix had accidentally sent me a disc with just an infomercial on it, but then I somehow managed to spot the play option and found the real movie. But the infomercial gets cut off as we see one of our main characters, Sarah Goldfarb, hurry to hide in a closet from her son Harry. Not convinced that he's her son? Don't worry, he'll shout it into your brain several times in this scene.
Trying to get me to break my own mother's set? Your own son, your own flesh and blood, Ma! Is that what you're trying to do, your own son?
We see that Harry loves to take his mother's television set and sell it to a pawn shop to support his drug habit. And as the scene progresses where they take the set to the pawn shop, I have to stop and point out the first strong point of this movie, the soundtrack. Even if you've never seen this film before, you've probably heard this number at least once. The music really adds to the feel of the film, and it's probably one of the best soundtracks I've gotten to mention since the Hunchback review. We cut to Harry and his friend Tyrone, played by Marlan Wayans, while they discuss the possibility of getting into drug dealing so they can actually have the money to buy themselves a better life than the one that they currently have. And as far as they're concerned, it's an easy plan that should go off without a hitch. A cop enters, sitting next to them, and Harry decides that now would be a great time to play monkey in the middle with the cop's gun.
Anything else?
Oh wait, never mind, he daydreamed the whole thing, and the scene moves over to Sarah, who is at the pawn shop to buy back her TV.
Why don't you tell already the police? Maybe they could talk to Harry. He wouldn't be stealing no more the TV.
Mr. Rabinowitz, I couldn't do that. Harry's my only child.
She goes back to watch more of the same infomercial when she gets a phone call telling her that she's just won a chance to be on television.
I'm calling to tell you you've already won. Mail-In and Block discovers contestants for most of America's television shows. You've already been chosen from a long list of potential contestants, meaning you've already won.
Oh.
Yes.
She goes back to her room to try on her old red dress, a dress she wore at Harry's graduation and has become symbolic to her of her proudest moment, but unfortunately it doesn't seem to fit anymore. We cut to Harry's girlfriend, Marion, played by the always gorgeous Jennifer Connelly, and we see the two of them sneak into an apartment building so they can hang out on the roof. Marion talks about how she doesn't like her parents, and Harry encourages her to follow her dream of designing clothes and opening up her own store. After their talk, they decide to set off the alarm, for whatever reason, and make out on the elevator as they escape. Meanwhile, we get a look at Sarah's new diet plan. And she decides to dye her hair red again. Unfortunately...
That's a red. I mean, red.
You're telling me that's red?
Yeah, I'm telling it's red.
Mm-hmm. Then what's orange? If this is a red, I want to know, what's orange?
And then we have this scene. Now, I will admit, the abrupt cuts in this movie are what makes it very strong to watch. But you spend most of the time in this scene trying to guess who's touching what. We see that Sarah's struggling to keep to her diet while watching the television rant about the evils of food. And she goes outside to get her mind off of it.
I'm thinking thin.
She's thinking thin.
My Louise, she lost 50 pounds just like that.
Like that?
Like what?
Poof!
What'd you do, put her in a sweat box?
No. She went to a doctor and he gave her pills you don't want to eat.
So? What's so good about that? You mean I'm sitting here not thinking about chopped liver and pastrami all right?
Ew. Just then the mail arrives, and she fills out the forms to be on TV while her friends eagerly walk her to the mailbox. Meanwhile, Tyrone gets a tip off of where he can get a pound of pure, and while Harry waits for him to return, he hallucinates, seeing Marion standing on the edge of a pier. Tyrone snaps him out of it when he returns, and they decide to try out their heroin just so they know how much to cut for their customers. We go back to Sarah, who can't take it anymore, and calls up her friend to get the number of the doctor who will prescribe her diet pills. Marion meets up with her therapist, who, we get the hint, is a bit of a perv. But she does it to keep her parents happy, even though Harry has a problem with it.
I don't understand why you gotta see him. Cut the son of a bitch loose, for Christ's sake.
Because I don't want him mentioning to my parents that I've stopped therapy. They're already so pissed off at me, they're thinking of cutting me off, you know?
We then see that the drug business is going surprisingly well for Harry, Tyrone, and Marion, even to the point where they're able to buy their own building for Marion to use as her shop. Sarah begins her new diet of four different colored pills, and we see that since she's pretty much on speed, her energy is all over the place. Harry decides that with his newfound fortune, he owes it to his mother to buy her something nice, so he gets her a new television and pays her a visit to let her know that it's on the way.
It's Harry!